Rick, could you stand on that down that way? Oh, she's in the midst of her prayer. Okay. Strike in. Strike down. Now, I'm just showing you. Strike in. Strike down. Okay? On three. One, two, three. Strike in! Strike down! Strike in! Strike down! Okay, sir. Not like this. This. You're using the arm like this. Okay? As a force. This is called from strike down! Strike down!
You can do things.
At this time, you can
think,
well, I'm just curious about that.
Take a
look at what you're holding
in
your hand
and see what else you put your finger
right in there.
Yes.
You just
at that time, metal are very strong joints. Very few of them are in the English and bamboo. Because of what we're going to stand up for the ring. You actually put it up. And you can hit somebody with it. It looks like funny when they show the cartoon for the older way to say hitting somebody. You're hitting somebody with something like this across their head. And now we get into the middle of it. If you, gentlemen, lady, no matter what your social standards, there's one thing that was something you all did. You paid. Everybody had one of these. It's a sturdy one. If you think it's broken, open up, open an artery. Everybody has one. Yep. Because there's 75% of the minutes like I mentioned. Or if you have one, there will be no more cost. Straight across. The idea is, remember, before endomines, all they could do to cauterize a wound was pour boiling water on it. Really bad green wood alcohol will burn it. If you said a crazy person who's screaming at you, you could try something in another way. So, with straight razors, it's like this. Somebody's like this with straight razors, they're an idiot. Because what's wrong with this position? Yeah. All right. I don't want to, in any way, limit where I'm going to go. No. You can change hands with the straight razor, not good hands in front, very careful, are sharp. These are actually from the 19th century. Except for this one right here, that's the new model. These are solar genius lasers. These, you would have something like this to defend yourself with. And if you're caught with it and you die, or you die, it's part of the daily tool. Just saying, yeah, I gotta go see somebody soon, so I gotta get a shake. So what we have here is a daily practice. The idea is, at the end of the day, you want to be the one walking home, you want to be the only single day. Gun was your best defense back then. You couldn't afford one. This comes up instead of a knife. Things could be in front of your leg. It could be tattooed in a sin, such as that was so civilized, you couldn't allow you to carry a weapon. You'd have to work with something like a walking stick, sword cane, sword of binding, something like that. Something like this. Now, he's having an issue about 5 years. So, as you can tell, they're still sharp. They'll still cut the other one. Even though. Now, ladies, remember what I told you earlier about changing a dance card? One of these up your sleeve, somebody gets up and gets your personal. You cut that arm, you cut something else, who cares? We're going to be called sweet.
One more question. So, are there any questions right now on what we've done with the so far?
Anything? Yes, sir.
Well, the razor, where are you holding it? Are you holding it across the pivot point? Are you holding it entirely below the pivot point?
It is a matter of individual style. Your purpose.
Would you have it open? If you have it like this, you're less likely to cut yourself.
That's
less likely to close on you because you're holding it like that. Same like if you're using a knife such as an open L. Now, other people would have it like this, so that way you know you're not going to cut yourself.
You're still in control.
Yeah.
And that's the critical part.
So if you basically have a guy going, now here's the thing, you see this? You left the handle. What do you see? Okay. So the lady goes up to the person, the guy who's doing this, and slaps him in the face along here, opens him up like a can of tomato soup. You'll bleed out. The idea is they bleed out. The idea is, remember, medical at that time wasn't advanced, it was today. Major cuts like this against arteries were more likely to get. They didn't have blood transfusion, they didn't have plasma scans. Once you bled out, you bled out. On the other hand, 20th century, I literally saw a man slit his throat with a razor blade. We stuck the bed sheet in and were transported. Survived. Got a nice little scar. Got his throat. Just slit his throat open. He survived. That's the difference between the 20th century and the 19th century. Also, what they can prove is they had no DNA evidence, fingerprints evidence in its infancy. It wasn't until the 20th century that in American courts, fingerprints were accepted as legal evidence. So at the close of the 19th century, it was allowed. The same with ballistic, what we call ballistic fingerprinting nowadays, ballistic markings on a pistol, wasn't just the 21st century, but it was really universally accepted. Knives, use them, dump them. By the way, the majority of the knives were carried by the bad guys and by the people in the street were kitchen knives. Because they've been easily explained why they were tossed. Somebody who really didn't have signature knife, unless they were high up on the food chain in organized crime. And he rarely used it because he didn't want to lose it, he didn't want to chip it away. They're expensive.
When you're talking about the use of a firearm, I showed them earlier. These are about the size of the weapons that were predominant in those times. Remember, long, thin, wide shot.
Oh yeah, and double action was really quite well known, quite well used. The Bulldogs, which were higher caliber, five shot, double action.
Can you explain what that means?
What?
Explain what double action means.
Okay, double action. This is the trigger, this is the hammer. Single action, you have to pull the hammer back, pull the trigger. Double action, you pull the trigger, and it brings the hammer back on its own. Okay? Now, they had ones that were called limit squeezers, break opens, safety, hammerless. Basically, what they did was they put a metal shielding over top of the hammer to make it underneath and concealed. The reason for this is keep it in your pocket, draw it out, and then bam, 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 five shots. But it would be a vest pocket, or a pants pocket. Remember, the main thing is, whenever you do say somebody has a dagger or something like that.
Now, I showed something earlier with the lady who's here. Could I get a volunteer from the other school? Ma'am, I would like someone larger than me. Now, sir, act like that's a club you're trying to hit. Okay, this is going to hurt you. However, this is going to hurt you even more. When you lap here, notice that I'm close to the elbow. Now, sir, take that and make sure you have to. That's what you would hear. Then you would be screaming like a pro. Because what I just did was shatter his elbow. And you would be screaming. Now, the thing is, then I would have the stick that he just now dropped. Now, he's on the ground. I got the stick he was trying to use on me. Wham! Wham! This also works for machetes. So, try again. Okay? And you notice I've blocked. Now, if you do it a little faster, the optimum place is to block right here. But if this is all you can do, that's fine. Remember I told you how they punched in that time period? Punch right there, as hard as you can. Now, that's gonna hurt. The second, that's the first punch. The second punch, right here. Third punch, up into the nose. In the Orient, they did an open palm like this. It's referral shots at the brain that tells you not something about the bone. Now, the thing is, what you can do with this also, if you block here, go forward, sweep the leg and knock them back. This was not just something that was used in Oriental martial arts. There was a very deadly martial art that was practiced in Europe. It's called sabot. Some people call it saboté. If they call it saboté, they're a dilettante. They're a person that's seen a sport. They still do this down in New Orleans. There's still blood matches where sometimes a person's left dead without the way. Sabot is developed in Marseille in the 13th century. I learned something about it from my grandmother. It was taught by her father. You think this is deadly? You think this is funny? At the time, I was a Jehovah's Witness. My brother and I saw somebody trying to come up with my grandmother in the alleyway outside the alleyway in Richmond, in the first place, was the only way you could do it close. 9 miles went up. Down there, my aunt Jane was standing there, she's on the judge's office. My name, that's what I call my grandma, was standing there. Are you hurt, young man? And there were three tossed on the ground, another one rolling around already. And the other person, what was left of his kneecaps, and Nanny had to go to the game. Then they found out that my half brother was also not a judge's witness, was the precinct. It was not a good day. In the time it took me and my brother to run down 2 flights of stairs, my orthopedic grandmother, who was a practitioner of Sabat, had taken these three tufts out. Mm-hmm. She was this tall. It is deadly. The sweeps of the legs, one of the things that they would do is after they knocked a person down, get the legs up here, and then they do a thing called kettle drum. Basically do like this on the person's balls until they start spitting blood. Yeah, there's a lot of striking to the genitals because it is effective. That's why we have developed pretty much nowadays that people guard them in any way they can. And that is a reaction that you can use. When a person comes up to try and guard that, guess what? They're off balance. Go for that. The person is afraid of something. Go for that. There is a whole plethora of things that you can read if you are what's known as a morphle. It basically, a morphle is a person that goes back and looks at the stats of when it's killed at the morgue. One of the more inventive things that was used in defense was a person who used a cat.
Yeah.
Yeah, they basically grabbed the cat by the tail and used it as a weaponized face.
We know how to face with a very unhappy cat.
But it was like, reinvent the catapult. Remember, you've got a little thing like a dog, a yap-yap dog. They are highly defensive. They are highly territorial about their humans. They have no conception of how big they truly are. And they're not that big. They will try anything. That will give you a distraction. Anything to distract you, to give you time to bring the boy self away. Yes, ma'am, you had a question.
I heard somewhere that while women aren't quite as vulnerable in that area, they are more sensitive in the front in general. Is that what you...
It depends. And the additional thing is, yeah, a woman kicked in the groin area will still go down. Yeah, take a look at some tapes from a match called... you ever heard of a game called Camogie? Mm-hmm. Irish field hockey. Women's.
Okay.
Yeah. Let's see, what was it? Organized violence.
Mogi
is
unorganized
violence.
Like,
you wanted to come forward and say, now, I'll show you what to do with this. What you're going to do is, now, in this case, you have to say your grace on your stick. Now, let go and I'll show you. You have it like this. Now, the person, the area does not allow you the time to do what we showed before. Take the parasol, take the stick. Okay? And then back like that, then in the throat. Okay? Going to the nose. Going. The two actions are this. You have forced the head back. Now it's going on its target area. It does not take that much. Destroy a person's larynx. To basically break that and they'll choke together on their own blood. They can't breathe. Remember, they haven't invented tracheotomies yet either.
They also can't tell the police their side of the story. Yeah.
The other thing is, if you have just this much room, holding it like this is along the lines of, now, right along here, everybody touch right here, push in. Feel how that hurts? It's a bundle of nerves right there. You're going to strike along the now.
We're going to go with unarmed.
You're in a situation where you're unarmed in that. Now. Okay. Now, you're going to have your hands up, and I'm going to try something like this. Mm-hmm. You don't want me there. What are you doing? Not only that, let me show you. Okay. Go like that. My arms are here. Another way, chicken neck. Now, if the person has an earring, this is brilliant. Everybody in 1981 was treated to the sight of me. What, you see that guy over there, the two gentlemen over there? Okay, about the same two combined, the size of this bruiser. And what they saw was me carrying, pulling him down the hallway. What they didn't see was I had keys in my hand. The old brass type keys, which are very much like the 19th century regular skeleton keys, or those type of box keys. You take the blades of the keys, you grab here, or you force the earring in. You want to grab right there? He would be here, or the earring would be forced into there. And the lady would say, come along, young man. A man, in this case, finds it very hard to what he's going to do is hit a woman because the legs are disguised because of the skirts. That's the only advantage you'll ever have on this. But you now have this person pulling down with that. If they have, many men at the time had pigtails. Hold the pigtails, pull down, push up, apply pressure. Okay? Another thing. Now, remember I keep talking about the self-harm process. Your body realizes
grabbing a woman from behind like this, she can basically take, remember I told you about the shoes, like those shoes she's wearing? Draw it straight down the top of the chin. If they're wearing anything other than the cowboy boots, it's gonna hurt. If they're wearing shoes like this gentleman is, it's gonna hurt because it's gonna go right down the leg. Stomp on the foot if you can. If not,